Good evening, everyone. Indeed, Ops is not really well known in France, at least. When I started as a CEO, I didn't really have any clue about what it was. But it's about problem solving and helping other people. So it's, I think everyone can do it with the right mindset. But it's true that more and more startups are setting up an Ops function. It started with US startups coming in France, and now you have more and more Ops in the market. And usually people that I meet during interviews don't apply for the Ops role. They apply for something else, country launch role, sometimes sales, sometimes finance. And I realized during the interview that they have the perfect profile for Ops, so I take them in the team. So today, so here is my email and my my Twitter. If you want to connect after that, there is a there shouldn't be any T here. It's Le Cantus, not with a T. And happy to answer your emails if you have questions or if you want to connect after the event. I wanted to so I'm going to discuss about three things. Four things actually, if we include a short introduction of what is Malt. Then we'll discuss about my understanding of what is the role of Ops. Then we'll discuss about the integration of the Ops team within the rest of the organization and the processes. And last but not least, we'll discuss about pure org and what profiles you should recruit as Ops and what you should look for when you want to build an Ops team. So a few words about Malt. So we are a freelancer marketplace. We were created 6 years ago in Paris by Vincent and two other co-founders who are both freelancers. So Malt is a freelancer platform built by freelancers. We opened an office in Spain a year and a half ago, and we opened an office in Germany 1 month ago. Actually, we don't have an office yet, but we have the apartment of our country manager. We are now a team of 110 employees in Europe. In France, we are in Paris and in Lyon. We have we built an office in Lyon right at the beginning because our co-founder and CTO Hugo went there to for his personal reasons, and we built our back-end development team around him in Lyon, which is much more convenient than Paris. We have we recruit much more easily. And people are very loyal. We had no turnover in Lyon for the last 5 years because there is less competition from startups and you don't have big US firms coming here and making the salaries explode. So it's very convenient. And many startups actually are trying to scatter their development teams in Nantes or in Bordeaux for the same reasons. And we raised a total of 32 million euros. The last round was 25 million with Idea Invest 3 months ago. And we raised this money to go in the rest of Europe, so first Germany, and I hope in other countries if we are successful. What we do, it's we are kind of riding the wave of freelancing. Freelancing is a huge trend in the future of work ecosystem. In France, there have been plus 147% freelancers in the last 10 years, so it's times 2.5. It's a huge huge growth, and we have close to 1 million freelancers in France. When I joined Malt 4 years ago, it was only 700K. So we follow the growth every year. It's pretty exciting. And France is the country where the number of freelancers have grown the most rapidly in Europe, probably because thanks to the auto-entrepreneur status that was created a few years ago, that really helped, because in just 2 days, you can have your own company and you can start invoicing clients. But the biggest markets are Germany and the UK, not surprisingly. Since there is little difference in terms of protection between an employee and a freelancer in the US and the UK, it's much more convenient and much more easy to jump into the freelancing world, because you don't lose as much as you can lose in France in terms of security, stability, etc. And out of these freelancers, we usually ask them how many choose to become freelancers. It's 90% of them, so it's always by choice, not by constraints. And why do they become freelancer? It's because they want more freedom. It's not always for money most of the time. It's for freedom because you are free to choose your boss, and actually you are free to choose your client instead of having a boss. You are free to work from where you want to work. You are free also to set your own price and to choose your projects. We decided to build a marketplace because at the time, 5 years ago, there was no really good option for local freelancers to find jobs. The only platforms that existed were US platforms or Australian platforms, namely Upwork and Freelancer.com. Or Fiverr, but all these platforms work the same way. The client posts a job, and then as a freelancer you need to apply with a price. And automatically this leads to a race to the bottom on prices that drives prices down and encourages a lot of offshore freelancers. So we wanted to reverse the approach to avoid this race to the bottom on prices with a marketplace that worked much like Airbnb, where a client is looking for a skill and a city. We are very local, we don't want offshore freelancers. And we display all the results of freelancers who are available and who match the client criteria. And today, on average, a client contacts 2.5 freelancers per project. So there's no large competition. Usually, if you are available and a client has contacted you, you have a very high probability to win the project. And it's not possible to filter and to have only the lower prices first, like Amazon. It's only based on quality and matching. We have ratings from clients, so you can also assess the quality and the skills of the freelancer. And as I said, it's based locally, so you look in a city. It's also a very open model. So here it's, I did this screenshot while I was not logged. So anyone can come on Malt and find a freelancer. And you don't need to apply, you don't need to pay or subscribe to anything to have the list of freelancers. That's what makes us the leader in France, because in 6 years we managed to bring on board a community of 120,000 freelancers in France alone. So it's pretty huge, especially on penuric skills like IT and UX. But we don't only manage the relationship, we also manage the entire contracting and projects with a payment system, online contracting system, an insurance, and we also set up some partnerships with Alan, for instance, for health insurance, with Open Classroom to help freelancers to train and to get some trainings. I saw when we asked you the question at the beginning that some of you are already in ops, so excuse me if we don't share the same view on the job, and happy to discuss about this later. For me, there is two missions for ops in a tech company. So I'm focusing here on a tech company, and I'm going to discuss a lot about the product team, because I think the product team and the ops team should work hand in hand together. So for me, there is two missions. The first one is to help smooth the relationship between the product team and the rest of the team. We noticed early on at Malt that when you started to have the product team speaking directly with the sales or with us, with the community team, or with the marketing team, it was always a bit complex, because if you have a team of 15 sales, the 15 sales will have a different idea of what is the biggest priority for the next quarter. They will all have different feedbacks from clients, that they will have some difficulty sometimes to prioritize. So as a product manager, when you deliver a new feature, you get dozens of feedback from everywhere, and it's really a mess to track these feedbacks, do a preconception of the, on the feature you are going to deliver. We tried several things. We created a Trello for all the sales to put their feedback. Then we created a Jira project dedicated for the feedback from the sales that we wanted to review every week to prioritize the features. And it never worked. Nothing worked. When we had everyone in the sales team giving some feedback, it was always a mess, and it was not not scalable and not sustainable. So in the end, we decided that it would be the role of the ops team to gather this feedback and to be the only point of contact between the sales team and the product team. What it allows us to do, it's also about testing. There should be a laser, but it's not working. So we are also testing some features because it costs a lot of money to develop a feature given the size of your tech team. So it's always easier to start with some automation on Google Sheet or Zapier to prove that something is actually working, to prove that the process is set up before industrializing into the product. So providing user feedback, structuring them, and also prioritizing them. And the last thing, it's also aligning product with a sales team. Because if you deliver a new feature and the sales team is not aware about it, the worst thing that can happen is that they heard about it from a client. They're going to be really pissed off. But it's not only about client features. It's also about having some processes and some features that are integrated directly in the processes of the sales team. For example, you want to launch a new feature, for example, at Malt, when we could have a client who would invite new users into his client account. If you just launch this feature like that, probably nothing will happen. So we integrated this into the process of the sales team and user speech. So we created the sales material for the pitch. We created the Q&A for the clients, but we also integrated this multi-user feature into the objectives. So the sales team, they had objectives and a bonus based on the number of multi-user accounts that they created. That way, we had a really nice launch of the feature, and then it's working automatically. And if you have a short boost on the sales performance linked to this, then they will keep having the speech for later, even when you stop the short-term bonus. So this part is really really important, and helping your product team to deliver efficiently and to be aligned with the rest of the company. And the other part, of course, it's about improving processes and tools for what we call the front office. For me, the front office, it's sales team and community management team, because we are a two-sided marketplace. So helping the people who are supposed to be directly the first line of contact of your users, helping them to improve their processes on a daily basis, helping them reduce waste, solving their problems. They have many issues, and sales is not supposed to problem solve and to create new processes to automate some Google Sheet. They are lousy at that. It's a waste of time for them to do that. We also set targets for our different teams. We define the right KPIs, and then we set targets on a monthly basis to help the sales manager to control their team. Of course, it's a discussion between the sales manager and the ops. We don't decide that on our own. It's a negotiation because, of course, the sales manager has a bonus on the result of this team. So it's his interest to have something that is achievable. And operations is also key from my point of view for internationalization. You don't want to launch your company abroad and to open a new office if you don't have crystal clear processes, because it's going to be a mess. If you multiply by two the number of countries, I think it's exponential, the complexity that you have with your other countries. So two countries is actually four times as difficult as one country. I also think that it's quite important to have a stronger operations team if you have a weak product team. So by weak, I don't mean that they are bad developers. I just mean that maybe it's less mature, and you build your company with sales and pitch and with very small or very early stage product, like a real MVP. And the stronger your product team is, the less ops you need. At Malt, we started only with me because we started first with a product, and then we sold, and we started to attract users and to build a sales team. So alone, I could manage the ops team for a while. But if we had started with just the search engine and we had nothing behind to manage contracting, payment, etc., etc., it would have been really a mess, and we would have needed more ops. So I've given an example, for example, on the right of Uber, or another startup I will talk about later. But at the beginning, when Uber arrived in France, they had just the app, the ride-hailing app. But they had really almost nothing on the product to onboard new drivers, to collect documents, to do some compliance check on the Uber drivers. So it was only done by the ops team. So they had a team of 10 people in Paris, and 6 of them were ops, because they had to do a lot of work manually. So when you are really early stage, basically you almost replace the product. So if you promise something, to the client, you just deliver it. If you are in a food delivery company, I think at the very beginning, the ops even take the bike to deliver the food themselves if there is no bike on the road. You really deliver the product yourself manually. And it's okay to do stuff manually that don't scale, at the beginning at least. Then by doing that, you will know what are the bottlenecks in your processes to optimize them later. So don't be afraid to do some very operational stuff. Then when you are in a scale-up like Malt at our stage, you start working on the features that the product will deliver to pre-package the features that the product team has a more detailed view on what they should deliver. You anticipate product features to train the frontline, and you prioritize the roadmap according to priorities of the company or client needs. And I think that the stronger the product is, the less work you have to do as an ops team. But there's always things to do in a startup anyway. So, what is important to keep in mind is that the operations team should not, the product team should not improve internal processes. I have spoken with a German freelancer platform recently. They had launched 1 year ago, and so it was a really small team with 4 people, and they had 1 developer. And for I asked them what they have been working on the product, and surprisingly, they only worked on an internal search engine for the other 3 people to look for freelancers faster than they would do manually in their database or in LinkedIn anything. And that was, for me, a complete waste of time. If you have 1 developer, don't concentrate him on improving processes that will make you save maybe 20% of your time. If you are 2 people, you just recruit a part-time, or you just recruit an intern, or a staffer from a side, or a temp worker. But just recruit more people to do the operational stuff instead of having the product team focusing on that. The product team should focus on long-term project and on delivering the actual service for your clients or on growth, but not on ops, not on things that you can manage as an op manager. So the product team, I estimate around 50k euro for 2 sprints of 2 weeks, so 1 month of work. So basically, if you want to improve something internally, keep in mind that it can cost you 50k for 1 month of work. So it's quite significant. So in our case, we systematically the product team pushes back the problems to the ops team, and then we take over to try to find a solution. So this is what we are saying to our sales team. Basically, they call us all the time with any issue they have. We always tell them that yes, it's an issue and we're going to help them. We don't say when exactly, but usually it doesn't take really long. So we try to improve processes, or we recruit more staff. It's simple as that. You have many options today to recruit short-term employees, classic temp companies like Adecco, etc. Freelancers, of course, if it's more high-value profiles that you need, for example, in finance or in stuff like that. You can also recruit freelancers ops. But there are many options for easier and cheaper short-term staff companies. I mentioned Side earlier. It's one of the family companies with students working on blue-collar jobs. So perfect if you have a database to clean instead of doing it yourself, or having the product team to one developer will spend 2 days to write a quick fix to help you clean your database. It's a waste of time. You should work on the product, recruit someone, and spend 2 days to do it manually. So there is a Side, also Easy Work, a new temp working company. StaffMe also works well. So don't hesitate to use these companies. Every time you think something will take too long to automatize, you find someone to do it manually. So a quick example, one of my friends was one of the first DOps at Uber. DOps means driver operations. At Uber at the time, there was only driver operations because this is a real big bottleneck in every country. And then later on, they had sales operations because they started to sell to restaurants, etc., etc. But they started with the driver operations. That was the key for the business for them, to onboard as many drivers as possible. And when he joined Uber in 2013 in Paris, they were onboarding around 10 drivers every week. And they went to 400 drivers a week in a few months, in a year. And that's pretty impressive. But first, they did everything manually. They didn't wait to have more people. They didn't wait for the product to deliver a new feature that would allow the drivers to onboard themselves manually on the app. It would have taken 6 months. And Uber succeeded because they didn't wait 6 months to do such stuff. They just recruited 5 ops who worked night and day to set up iPhones that they would give to drivers when they joined. And at the beginning, it was really that every driver, they did some Facebook ad saying Uber is coming, make 5,000 euro a month, enjoy and come at our office. So they had office hours, open hours at their office, and they welcomed the drivers manually, meeting them, explaining manually and how everything worked. Then they started to create onboarding materials and videos so that they would repeat, they wouldn't repeat the same message day over day. Then they created their own quick survey that freelance drivers filled, so that they could tell them, no, your vehicle is not appropriate, or making sure basically that when they come physically in the office, they were 90% completed, and you just have to scan the documents and to onboard them on the platform. And I think they quickly also recruited interim workers once the processes were set up. So it was not until they had the Google form sent to the physical meetings that they really understood at what funnel, what stage of the funnel were the drivers blocked, that then they recruited interim workers. They did that because no, the processes were set up and they didn't have to, they could rely on someone who would follow a very clear process. And I think at some point they had 150 interim workers working on driver onboarding. That was huge because they had a team of 25 people full-time, so it was seven times the size of the team. And after that, Uber at the time was working more on the algorithm, the matching algorithm. After that, they integrated the automatic upload of document in the platform, and it came years later in 2015. But that didn't prevent them from growing up to 20,000 drivers in Paris. So a few examples of what we do concretely at Malt in the Ops team. We take care of basically when we see an issue in the funnel at any point, we try to solve it with our own tools. So for instance, we have some we set up some automatic messages with Intercom. Intercom is a tool that manages chat, for instance, with your users, but you can also program emails with a few simple trackers on the website. So anytime a freelancer doesn't complete his profile, we send him some reminders through Intercom. We also send reminders to clients who only contact one freelancer because we noticed that the conversion rate was 30% higher when you contacted at least two freelancers, which is completely obvious, but still, we measured it. So if a client contacts one freelancer, we set up also a message for this. We developed our own internal CRM at Malt that we have called Shake. At a point in time, we really hesitated between between building our own CRM and working on Salesforce. And we decided to go with the first option because we are a two-sided marketplace, and using Salesforce would have meant to create a lot of dedicated objects in Salesforce, and it would have been really, really complicated in a technology that we don't master. So for us, it was a no-go. Plus, we would have been locked with Salesforce for a long time, and it's quite expensive. So we decided to start from scratch and build our own CRM. So the Ops team made all the specs, and we are still improving it month after month to add new internal features. We are really, really happy about it. But if we had gone with Salesforce, it would have been the role of the Ops team to manage the entire project, hiring Salesforce developers, setting up the specs, etc. At Doctolib, for instance, I know there are extensive users of Salesforce, and they have two or three people, 100% dedicated, to manage and improve Salesforce. So I think that falls in the scope of Ops, unfortunately. We also do some automation. For instance, when one of our community members onboards a great freelancer, we send an automatic Slack message to the sales team who are interested in this technology to tell them Fanny has just onboarded Nicolas, have a look at this profile, and if the profile is good, they send it to their clients. And we're also working on giving everyone a better view on our KPIs and on where we stand in a the business point of view. So we built a lot of dashboards for our sales and community team. I think there are almost 300 dashboards at Malt. And it really increased also the performance. It's like gamification. Gamification, we started to do it for our users because if you rank freelancers saying they are in the top 10%, top 5%, etc., and how they could improve, they usually do it. It's like Waze. You know, if you are using Waze, some people are okay to do a detour to get a badge, and there's nothing behind it, and there's no money. You just have a badge, and it works quite well. And so we noticed that it was almost the same thing when we created some dashboards for the sales team, instead of having a leaderboard somewhere and updated on a monthly basis. We have real-time data on the sales performance, on the biggest clients, on the activity, on the search engine, on everything. And the sales team started to compete with each other. And we see that when Chartio is our business intelligence tool, when it's down, you really immediately see a decrease in activity on the floor. So it's quite quite amazing. So we work on other stuff as well. We work on the client segmentation, of course, to have a sales organization dedicated for each client segment. We work on target setting, as I said already, some marketing automation, and last but not least, knowledge management and processes. Knowledge management is always something you tend to do last, or you always have it on your to-do list and you never do it because it's quite heavy. What I suggest if you are starting as Ops, it's to find a good tool for knowledge management early on and to start writing everything right from the beginning. If you do it only after 2 or 3 years, when you start realizing that oral tradition is not working anymore and that you need to write things down, it's already too late, because you have 2 or 3 years of backlog, and it becomes a huge project that someone will need to spend maybe 100% of his time for 1 year to work on the backlog again. So it's quite annoying. At Malt, we started with Confluence from Atlassian, the same editors as Jira. It works okay, but it's ugly. I think that something needs to be beautiful if you want people to use it. So we switched to Notion. Notion works actually quite well. If you have other tools, feel free to share or to send me an email, and I will write. By the way, it's a good idea. If you have any tips on other tools, send them to me after the meetup, and I'll try to use the family to share them to everyone after that. So we switched to Notion, who's much more efficient and nice to look at. So what you want to avoid as ops in your mission is to first unfocus the product team from the challenges of the product. So that's what I said at the beginning. I think it's very important to relieve the product from these petty things and to let them work on big strategic things. Wait also too long before recruiting. We had a sales manager who told me we should first work on process efficiency, to make sure that our sales team can deliver more with fewer resources, and then we will recruit more. I think it's a big mistake. If you're in a tech startup, you will grow fast anyway, very fast. So you need to do both in parallel, and don't wait to recruit. You should always be recruiting, always be meeting people in the ops team or the sales team, because if you recruit someone maybe 2 months earlier, you will find some work for them, and you will anticipate your growth. Grow lazy. I'm saying that because, on the contrary, you can recruit a lot, but you should not be lazy and stop improving processes because you have a lot of money and you can recruit. You must always be very, very sharp to try to improve processes and reduce waste and increase efficiency. Because at some point, even if you're a startup, you need to reach for profitability. And you don't want to wait 15 years to have McKinsey consultants come to you and spend 5 months to help you improve processes, etc. You are better placed to do it. I know, I've done both. use the product to improve internal processes while they are not completely set up. The worst thing that can happen is if you manage to have some bandwidth from the product team, they work on something for you, and then 5 months later, you stop using it because you decided to change the processes, change the organization, externalize a part of the activity. That's the worst thing that can happen. You will never get some goodwill from the product team after that. So be very, 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 rigoureux. Sorry, you speak French anyway. To make sure that your processes are completely set up before you ask the product team to industrialize it. One thing, and I think we are not doing it great at Malt, because it's very difficult and it's something we definitely need to improve. But as an ops manager, you will get dozens of requests every day or issues to solve. Some stuff that you try to automate that doesn't work anymore because you change an email in one of the files. It will be because you have an issue with the client. You need to help a team member. Basically, you will spend your day to have some people ask for your help. So it's very difficult to balance the time you spend on this tactical stuff compared to the big opportunities and the big projects that you need to work on. So what I would suggest is to build a roadmap for your operations team. That you validate with the management, and it's like a product roadmap. So you try to validate this roadmap with a few long-term initiatives that can take up to 30% of your bandwidth, and then the rest will be filled anyway with daily improvements. Examples of long-term initiatives are typically knowledge management. If you don't pay attention to knowledge management, you will never do it, including for the ops team. You need to also write things that you do yourself, not things that you do for other team. We recently recruited two operations managers at Malt, and one of their feedback was that we didn't onboard them at all the tools that we used. The business intelligence tool, Zapier, Google Sheet, everything that we learned on our job for 2 years, we never spent some time to try to standardize it, because at the time there was only me for 2 years, then Remy and I for a year and a half, and when there's the two of you and you are seated next to each other, you don't need to write anything down. But you will start to recruit some people in your team later on, so anticipate this. So here is the ops team at Malt today. So we are a team of 110 people. It's a small operations team. We are in the process of recruiting two people between 3 to 5 years experience. So if you want to apply, welcome. So the ops profile are a mix between top sales and business and engineering school. So HEC, Central Lyon, or l'UM Lyon. Usually people who have either or both experience in consulting or in startups. I think it's really important to have both. If you can have the best of both worlds, it's even better. Someone who has done a few years of consulting, then went into a startup to be more hands-on. But if you are meeting some people who are consultants, what you need to check is why the reason they left consulting. And it's not; it should not be because they are tired and they want to find a more relaxed job. You should find someone who left consulting because they felt they didn't have any immediate impact. They didn't do stuff on their own. I recently recruited an ex-McKinsey to be country manager for Germany, and I liked when he told me that his development opportunity at McKinsey was to be less 80-20. Because he went too fast, he was too 80-20, and not enough perfectionist for McKinsey. And that's the perfect feedback you can have for someone to join your ops team. Because you want someone who is okay with a gray area, who is okay to get things done quickly. Done is better than perfect. So you should aim for this kind of profile, who are okay to do something quick and dirty that works, and then find something more beautiful and more efficient the next day. So as I said, we are recruiting, so don't hesitate to hop on Welcome to the Jungle and apply. You can also find in the job description a lot of things that we do at Malt in Ops, and it also reflects what I think is a good Ops profile. In terms of skills, what you are looking for, it's someone very analytical. You need to prove everything with figures if you want the product to help you industrialize part of your job. Be very optimistic, because you are going to solve everyone's problem all the time. So if you're not optimistic and someone comes to you with a problem and you say, oh, it's complicated, it won't work. So you have to be smiling and say, don't worry, it's going to be fine. That's what you mentioned earlier. About me, you need to help everyone, and it's people will start to lose confidence sometime in a startup. You know, there are ups and downs, and sometimes there are downs, and some people can become very desperate because they don't believe that you can multiply your revenue by 2 or by 3 in a year. For them, it's completely unrealistic, especially if you come from a traditional company. So you have to be optimistic to. Because optimism, it's like smiling. It spreads over everyone in the company. So you need to be at the center of this at the company, and also at the center of ambition. The last point is ambition. I think it's very, very, very important for ops manager to see the opportunities and not the obstacles. If you have someone who is quite negative and complains and always reminds what's not going to work or the caveats in everything they do, it's not the right profile. You need someone who says, yes, of course, we're going to deliver it. Just tell me how much, and then I'll tell you what I need to make it a success. So just a small view on what I did at Malt over the years and what has changed over the course of time. Because when I joined the company as COO, there were only five of us. So of course, when there are five of you, you can do pretty much everything. So I managed admin and office management, accounting and stuff like that, payroll, ticket resto, all this stuff, phone also, setting up the call center, finance, setting targets, but also dealing with investors. So that when I joined, we raised 1.5 million with Isaïe. So I led this with our CEO Vincent, and then I kept working on reporting for Isaïe and our other investors. I built the sales team, so I recruited a team of at the time 5 people. Now we are 35 in the sales team, and I took care of legal and HR. Legal, you have lawyers, of course, to coordinate. but I think it's good to do it yourself at the beginning to have a good understanding of what are the risks of your company, and HR. So I left office management in 2016 to start working on operations. There was no really operation at the time because there was no sales back then. Then we recruited a head of a CFO in 2017, and I took the community team. And then in 2018, we recruited a talent manager, an HR. So I didn't do that anymore. And we also recruited a head of sales. But of course, it's something. Some people are afraid to lose part of their scope and their job because everyone tends to feel that the bigger the scope you have, the better you are, and it's more rewarding for you. I think you should aim at the contrary. You should aim at putting yourself out of a job because there will be stuff to do anyway. And even if you recruit someone, you will spend some time to challenge them, to help them getting on board, etc. So you will not lose your scope. People come to the ops because you are helping them, because they trust you. So you should not try to force you as a manager of other people. People will come to you anyway if they trust you and if you help them solve their issues. And you don't need a big team to do that. And actually, personally, I'm not a big fan of management. It's ages of one-to-one development goals and salaries request. I prefer to solve problems, so I'm better when other people deal with the management. So when do you need to start recruiting your hubs? I think it's usually ASAP. One investor told Vincent when he hired me in 2015 why he recruited a CEO that fast, and I think it was a great idea at the time, not only because it was me, but because it really made sense. There are plenty of stuff at the beginning that you don't see, many inefficiencies, many stuff that could become huge issues when you start to have a lot of users. So it's really important to have someone right at the beginning who tries to aim at something very scalable, to try to also define the right processes right at the beginning. It also really helped to have a lot of data when we raised with Serena in 2016, because at the time we already had Chart.io with a lot of business intelligence. They had never seen that in any of the companies they had invested in before, and it really also built confidence and trust in us, because we really knew our figures, we really knew our businesses, and we really knew our end-to-end processes. We were not doing everything par hasard. So I think it's not maybe day one, but it's really really important to have some ops team right at the beginning, especially, again, right, what we said at the beginning, especially if you don't have a strong product team. How I define operations at Malt when someone joins, it's the center are the key, le maillon, le moteur, si vous voulez, between finance, product, marketing, and the front office team, community and sales. We help finance to set targets. We help the finance to build their business plan by giving them some realistic targets. Because if your CFO doesn't know if it's realistic to go from 25 to 30% conversion rate. He has absolutely no clue. So he can build a business plan based on some KPIs that don't rely on any operational stuff. So we help him to define what are the potential improvements that we can make on every KPI of the business plan to build our targets. We help on setting targets for sales and the bonus. Product team, we help on the Shake, our internal CRM, give them product feedback. And the marketing, we link with the sales team. For example, if we have a new campaign on LinkedIn that attracts a customer on a dedicated landing page, you need some sales to manage this client. So it's good if you are aligned and the sales team knows about this. And so now that we have different countries, I define the ops team as a link between the central team working for the global markets and the markets. So what I call the markets is the team working on the delivery in every country. So in our case, sales and community. I think the role of operations varies a lot, and you won't find two operations team with the same scope in any company. But this is the org chart of Malt, so we also have a sales, head of sales, vacant position right now that I manage at the beginning. We have technology, product design and conception, and marketing and HR. That's weird, something is missing. A friend of mine works at EasyWork, and there is a new stuff that we don't manage at Malt. It's contracts and workers' pay. Because they didn't integrate yet the contracting and insurance, etc., for the contracts that they have with their clients, so the ops does that. I'm pretty sure that in a few months or in a few years, they will integrate it in the product. But right now, it sits with the ops. At Uber, the ops worked a lot on driver acquisition and onboarding because that was the key points to that to unlock growth in a country. For EasyWork, it's more about managing risk and delivering the service to your client. In an interim company, the contracting and the payroll of your employees, it's a core business for you. But EasyWork is a typical company where they started to launch the product before having the actual product. So they deliver the service for the client. At Uber, the service is more about finding drivers and clients. Maybe back in the early days of Uber 10 years ago in San Francisco, the ops team actually found drivers by themselves. It's probable. But in France, they started to work on driver acquisition and onboarding and international expansion. So the ops team was in charge of expanding into different cities. And because when you launch in a city, the first thing you need is drivers. So they launched drivers and they organized events in every city in France to find more drivers. Alma, it's a fintech. I think in fintech, you also work with fraud management and compliance. Because fraud is a big risk in your company. You're not going to recruit a fraud expert when you are two or three people. So first you do it with ops to identify the different strategies. But you need someone very generalist and senior to also work with compliance and regulation. So basically, in terms of organization, I think it depends on the priority of your company. Ops will help you to deliver the service no matter what, even if you don't have the product. And will help you to unlock growth if you see that you have something very operational to deliver. And in this case, ops should not be afraid of doing stuff that are not scalable. Again, it's really important to have your hands dirty and not be afraid of doing stuff manually yourself. Because the second time you will do it, you will find a way to do it in half the time it took you the first time, and so on and so forth. So in the end, it won't take you a lot. I wanted to discuss quickly about the OKR process because we did the OKR methodology at Malt a few months ago, and I think it was very efficient. So I'm not going to deep dive on what are the OKRs because there are plenty of reading on this on the market. But if you don't know, I suggest you have a look on Google on OKR and you try to get some literature on this. I will share you a few links by email after the talk. But basically, OKR, the objective is to align the entire company on a few objectives, on very key objectives. So if you have been a consultant before, forget about trying to be exhaustive. Writing OKRs is really setting key objectives, and you should not cover everything. You should make choices. The hardest thing in doing OKR is to make a choice and to say, we are not going to work on this, we are only going to work on this. But you need a few priorities, and only a few. Do not cover everything. So you set a few priorities, and then you cascade these objectives in different results, and then you try to cascade it by team or by individual. So what we did, and I think it worked well, and I strongly recommend to do it, is first to sit down with the top management and the board to define what are the key things you need to crack for the next month, for the rest of the year. It could be, in our case, we want to crack a few very large corporate clients to show the market that we can deal massively with freelancers for a few markets, and then the other will fall. So we don't say we want to reach X million on the corporate market. No, we say we want to crack two or three big companies. It can be we want to increase the self-service product from 20% to, I don't know, 60%, something like that. So a few, two, three, four really big objectives. You sit down with management, you define these targets. Then we conducted a workshop where we had the different managers from all the team who prepared the workshop, and we gave them the objective, and we told them what are the initiatives that you are going to work on each of these key objectives. And then what are the other initiatives that you have in mind that don't fit into any of these objectives. And we sat down together, all of us, and we said, okay, so tell us about your initiatives aligned with these OKRs. We agreed on which one are the most important. And then we had a look at the other initiatives that didn't belong in the OKR, and we cut down. And we said, no, this one, we don't agree, it's not a priority, so you should focus more time on the priority. And of course, you are not going to work only on the OKR. But at least everyone should be working on the same initiatives at the same time when it comes to these OKRs. So during this workshop, we established a product roadmap. The product roadmap is done by the product team, the product manager and the CPO. They have only four or five squads, so they can only deliver a finite number of features. So we sat down all together to define what are the most important ones. We put everything on a board, and we started to take away the post-its by order of from the less important to the more important. And only when did we finish the product roadmap, we worked on the ops roadmap. Because it must be a negative. You work on the product roadmap, and by using this roadmap, you know on what things the ops should work before. So I'll show you an example. It's a fake example of our product roadmap. And on this example, we say, for instance, that we are going to work on the CRM for the team. So we already did that, but we are going to work on the CRM for the team. We are going to set a new pricing in Q3, and we are going to work on the app. So you keep this product roadmap, and then you try to see on what projects you will need the apps before and after. For the CRM, we need to define all the specs before the product is actually ready to work on this. For the multi-user account, we need to understand the client feedbacks. And then, once we have delivered the product, then we start working on objectives and processes for the sales team. So you work in parallel with the product team, but I think it comes later, because the ops team is more agile and flexible than the product team. And then at the end of the year, I think you should always keep some time and some bandwidth to work on the budget, because it's quite a heavy process, and the ops team should definitely be involved to make sure we have reachable objectives. So I'm going to finish by two pages on a few tools that I found useful. So in terms of communication with clients, we use A/B testing. A/B testing, it's an A/B testing software. But we found a cool way to use it. We use A/B testing to change some part of the website, depending on the on some messages that we want to show to clients and to freelancers, because it can be used by the back office, by the ops team, without any help from the developers team once it's already set up. So we use A/B testing for A/B testing, but also to change part of the website, a banner, a message, something like that, or a special offer that we want to show. Intercom is quite powerful to manage in-app chat. And as I said, it's not only to manage chat, you can also send emails to your customers. It's emails that don't look nice, but it's fine because we want them to appear as personal email from people and not as a newsletter, so it works perfectly for that. And a front app, it's a group email inbox, but actually it's quite famous now, so everyone should know about it, but when we started using it, we were one of the first users. So front is really, really good for the support team and every team that needs to manage a lot of users. So we also use it at the community, not only at the support team. And I think it's much more convenient than Zendesk. Then Lusha, it's a tool to so the second one is about sales and prospection. Lusha is a tool to find phone numbers of your prospects on LinkedIn. It worked well, but one of our sales found the number of the wife of his prospect and not his prospect, so it was a weird conversation. MailTrack helps you to track the opening of your emails. Works quite well. I haven't put here YAMM, yet another mail merge, so YAMM. It helps you to send massive emails in a sequence, just with a Google Sheet and a template in a draft in your inbox. So it's a zero effort, zero integration. And you can send an email to 50 people, 100 people, and see whether or not they have opened the email. So it's a cheap version of MailTrack, but it's also a bit more massive because, for instance, for us, it's helpful if we want to contact 20 freelancers for a project. Instead of sending or calling 20 freelancers, we send them this email, and we see who has opened, who has not opened, and we only call people who did not open the email. Sales Navigator, I think it's a really powerful tool for salespeople. LinkedIn is not really used for this, but it's really powerful because you get some news from your email or from your prospects, what link they have posted recently, etc. So it helps you to be more personal. Of course, it works better for corporate sales. It's not for SMB sales where you need massification. But if you want to address someone and to reply on an article he posted 2 days ago, Sales Navigator works well. Calendly, have some people who can book your agenda just by looking at it. Google Sheet, of course. Zapier. Splash. Splash that is quite cool to create landing pages, especially for events. It's really easy to use and to set up, and you can get some data after the event. Notion is what we use for knowledge management. Dashlane, quite interesting to share some passwords. So it's not only for your personal use to have some passwords, but it's also easy to share some passwords with someone. So if you have some softwares with a shared login, if you are cheap and you don't want to take licenses for everyone, for instance, you can use Dashlane to share a password to someone else. That way, it avoids you to it prevents you, it helps you to keep the same password all the time. If someone leaves the company, you don't have to change the password again. You just take him away from Dashlane because he never actually saw the password. He got a key from Dashlane to use to open the app, but he never saw the password. So you just take people away and take people in and not change the passwords all the time. Chart.io is our business intelligence tool. It helps you to build some queries in your database with a drag and drop feature. So very easy if you don't use SQL. I didn't know how to use SQL. Actually, I still don't know how to use SQL. And I managed to do some pretty cool stuff with Chart.io. And on roadmap, it's a nice tool also to build roadmaps in a easier way than Jira, who is, to be honest, a bit complicated to use. And some interesting readings. So 4 books, it's not huge. you should be able to read them quickly. La 25e heure, it has been written by Guillaume Declercq, the founder of Loom. It's a tool on productivity. It interviewed a lot of entrepreneurs, and it really helped. I think there are a few good tips. Rework is fairly well known. Blitzscaling, it's from Reid Hoffman, the co-founder of LinkedIn. So Rework, it's more about culture and focus, how to be focused and how to have to build a great culture in your company with no meetings. Blitzscaling, it's more about, the title speaks for itself. Scaling really fast, forgetting about fires, focusing only on what matters to deliver growth. And Measure What Matters, it's a great book on the OKR methodology. So if you don't know anything about it, it's a good way to start. And that's it for today. Que l'enfant des vies.